conversations between myself, my colleague Susan Ormsby, and the body of consciousness that we know as Sounds from Source. So if I do mention Sounds from Source, please know that the Sounds from Source programs are spiritually based metaphysical tools that are downloaded, and that all solutions which are offered are from a spiritual and metaphysical viewpoint and should not be taken as medical, construed as medical advice. Studio A, if you'd like to call in and listen, 605-562-4199, and Studio B, 605-562-4200. So I'm hoping that we've managed to add Sharon Ann. I'm just...
Hi, Sheila, I'm here.
See you with me, Sharon Ann.
Hi, how are you going?
Says I have you, but whether we do or not is another thing.
Sheila?
Yes, hi. You're there. Good,
yes,
good.
I'm here. Sorry, I had the mic still muted.
Muted?
And I'm here with
well, I was trying to add you on your other Skype and it wouldn't come through. Then I was trying to read in the chat room whether that was my microphone or... whatever, not quite sure.
Well, we're both here now, don't worry.
You're here, that's fantastic. And you've got a wonderful guest for us tonight, Sharon Ann.
Yes, definitely. Karen Langford, do you have the bio I sent through?
I do. Karen Langford's a hypnotherapist, a regression therapist. This is one amazing lady, a rebirther, clairvoyant medium, author, and ET experiencer. And there aren't many people that combine all of those things. I'm really excited to meet Karen this evening. And Karen's based in Australia, as Sharon and I are, Sharon Ann. So Sharon Ann and Karen are both in Brisbane, and I'm down in Victoria currently. So Karen facilitates groups and workshops, and she also offers sessions for people in person and over Skype, etc. But Karen's also been the guest medium for Ken Morris's Psychic Choice Radio Network, located in the UK, and appeared at a number of spiritual churches doing platform mediumship. So we'll be sharing Karen's Facebook and website in the chat room and as we go along. And fantastic to have you join us, Karen. Thank you.
Oh, nice to meet you, Sheila. Happy to be here tonight.
Fantastic. So I don't know whether Sharon has told you, we tend to play it by ear and go with what comes up. So I'm going to really look forward to having a chat to you ladies tonight and see what's happening in your part of the world. You've got the... I can't think of the name, but Sharon Ann, the conference coming up, haven't you?
Yes, I can't wait. Actually, I'm working on the brochures at the moment. I'm going to be hosting a panel of ufology specialists at Paracon Australia on the last weekend of May down in the Blue Mountains. And on my panel, I'll be interviewing Mariana Flynn, who's the president of UFO Research New South Wales, Cheryl Gottschall, who's the president of UFO Research Queensland, Damien John Knott, who's an amazing anomaly photographer, and he's just been featured in the movie Australian Skies, he being the main portal, you could say, and of course Barry Taylor, who's another anomaly photographer. It's going to be quite an hour of entertainment. I've tried to get the questions that we're going to be asking to a different level, so above because of the quality of the audience. So
fantastic.
I don't think you've been to Paracon yet, have you, Sheila?
No, I haven't. And I couldn't even remember the name, but isn't that dreadful? I was reading yesterday, I think, about the panel that you were putting together, and it sounds really exciting. So I'm keeping... my options open, whether I can actually manage to get there. I haven't said no yet. So you never know. I might just see you there, which would be really awesome.
That would be wonderful. So, I mean, the talent this year is amazing. Alex Kayas, who's the organizer, he really goes out of his way to get some amazing international speakers. But he also does a brilliant job of rounding up the Australian-based ufology community too. I really look forward to this event every year now because I get to catch up with most of my columnists, actually, which is lovely. But also,
that's really awesome, isn't it?
Yeah, it's actually more of an Oddities E-Club get-together. So I should actually schedule a magazine dinner when I'm down there, I think. I'd capture at least 10 of our columnists on and off. Easily.
That's fantastic. I know, having met you in person, how good that is to put a face to a name, obviously. But also the energy, you know. I was actually talking to someone a couple of days ago and said, I tried to buy a writing pad with difficulty. People just don't seem to connect other than electronically anymore. I ended up buying a pad of three not particularly great writing pads, all in a thing that really wasn't what I was looking for, but that was the only thing I could get. So now I've just managed to add Rodrigo, so we get to have some extra fun tonight. Welcome, Rodrigo. You here with us?
Hey, Rodrigo.
How are you?
You are fantastic. And we have a lovely lady here with us tonight, Rodrigo, Karen Langford, who's also an Australian. So Karen will be of interest to you as well. Karen's a hypnotherapist, regression therapist, rebirther, clairvoyant medium, author, and ET experiencer. So she talks about lots of great stuff.
She's also very good at origami. I'm just messing with you.
I like origami. It's something I've never been able to do. But Rodrigo runs a show, Karen, as well, on Revolution Radio called Expanding Into Consciousness. So he's has some very interesting guests as well. I only got the second half of your show this morning, Rodrigo. I didn't allow for the not being daylight saving, and I was an hour late. But I did hear the second half. With Peter Moon, which was very interesting.
Yes, discussions about time travel and time travel technology.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he was actually very interesting, Sharon, and he was talking about the Sphinx in Romania, along with a lot of other things, but that part of it really interested me because he was talking about the tunnels and so on, going to different places, including the centre of the Earth and beneath the earth, and so on, which sort of fascinates me quite a lot. So it was good to listen in.
Yeah, this is amazing because I've just spent the last month, I've got in my hot little hands the Time Travel Handbook by David Childress. So I've just read that in the last month. I've just interviewed the director for Packing for Mars, and he and I had a great discussion on the chronovisor, which if you've done any time travel research, you know all about the chronovisor and things like that. And tonight, a little later, I'm going to talk to you about a project called Ancient Arrow and the Wingmakers. So I don't know, am I going to reiterate some of the stuff you've already covered today, Rodrigo?
We did touch base on a bit of Wingmakers.
Oh, cool.
So, but there was I think his point of view is a little bit different than most.
Okay.
We didn't touch base too much about it, but we did discuss a little bit. Peter Moon is a researcher from time travel. He's discussed with topics with Preston Nichols and Al Bielik, who were part of the Montauk Project, and he's done a few books. And on the 11th of May, I'm going to be interviewing presidential candidate and also another time traveler, Andrew Di Passaggio.
Oh, wow. I'm going to tune into that.
So, yeah, it's going to be an interesting show.
Yeah,
sounds good.
It's a fabulous topic. Yes, I started at MK Ultra And it's kind of gone from there. So the last, I'd say actually the last 6 weeks. And I, do you know where's Henry and his papers? Rodrigo?
No. Well, no,
he's got the most amazing site online. And so I've been chatting to him too. And he's given me all this extra information about Project Arrow and the Wingmakers and all that too. So anyway, we'll discuss that down the track.
Very good.
Excellent.
It was good to connect with like-minded people.
Well, it's meant to be, I think. But that's kind of like, what's it, synchronicity working?
Yeah, I think so, yes.
Yes, yeah, so I'm actually a bit sick of time travel now, to be honest, but after 6 weeks of it. But I had a lovely interview with Frank Jacob. He's a documentary filmmaker. The interview actually came out today, so I'll shoot you the link if you like, Sheila, so you can put it up on.
That'd be awesome. Yeah, and we can share it. Yeah.
And he and I, he's just made a 2-hour movie all about MK Ultra, all about the Moonshadow program, all about the Chronovisor, all these different devices, and it's an amazing documentary. It's not your typical dry kind of boring documentary either. It's been beautifully done. I mean, the landscapes that he captures, it's basically a road trip throughout America to all the places that time travel has occurred, or they believe certain projects have occurred, and the linkage between time travel and jump rooms to Mars. So Rodrigo, if you've been into all this too, you'd know exactly what I'm talking about. Hopefully.
Yes. Yeah. About the chrononauts and the jump rooms to Mars. Yes.
Yes, and all that sort of stuff. So he's at this gentleman.
More interested in a little bit of those topics. Yes.
Yes, this gentleman, Frank Jacob, he's just released this movie called Packing for Mars. Have you heard of that? So anyway, it was released.
I've heard of it, but I don't know much about it.
Well, I might put the link up to the website too, if you like, on the chat room.
No.
And so if anyone wants to go and check it out, it's amazing. It's the first 20 minutes or so really are...
That'd be awesome. Thank you.
Yeah, it's really... The first 20 minutes are really just an overview. So if you've already done your research into time travel, you might want to skip ahead to the Project Camelot interviews. And but some of the people he's been able to interview in this documentary will blow your mind away. And some of the footage of the moon... The moon footage that he's got, I've never seen it before. So it's just amazing.
Sounds awesome. So we may run into some internet problems, guys. I don't know about anyone else. I'm in Victoria at the moment, and the internet here has been shocking. Very, very slow to load anything. I noticed we've had a couple of little glitches in the call. So, just keep talking if we seem to drop out, because it seems to come back in again. But I'm not sure why, whether it's the weather. I was saying to Rodrigo yesterday, we should be in autumn here in Victoria, and we sort of had this Indian summer. It's almost like being in Queensland. So... I'm not sure what's happening there. And, for some reason, the net seems to be extremely slow or a little bit touchy. So we'll just keep our fingers crossed that the call continues on really, really well. So, Karen, you interested in time travel and all of these things as well, I would think, by your bio?
Well, yes, most definitely. It's always intrigued me, the actual physical time travel, not something that I have done personally. But I remember reading a few years ago a book about Sai Baba, and many people had accounted where he had been in two places at one time. So I guess this is another form of defying time and space. But in my work and my research is about accessing subconscious memories in the past and whether that's going to childhood or past life. And when you access the subconscious in the way, in this way, it acts like a portal into that experience, and that's where it opens the portal and allows for healing to take place of any trauma. And you actually get the butterfly effect and feeling the effects today in your life. It does actually change something. Time travel is a very interesting topic. Whether going to future life or past life, I have actually had some people go into the future. But after my exploration on the topic, I feel that when you go into the deep into the subconscious, it actually collapses time and space. Now, and this is similar to when I've had the experiences, the remote viewing experiences, whether it's been on board a ship or on a planet or just being in outer space. It's by stopping the conscious thoughts and going into these deep meditation or levels of deep meditation that allow for these experiences. I'm deeply fascinated with time travel, but I believe it doesn't have to be done in a physical sense. That's for sure.
I think Rodrigo and I are in the same place with you there, aren't we? We both studied over the years holographic kinetics, where you're going back down through time and accessing the past memories or forward into the future. And I know some of the conversations you and I've had, Rodrigo, we've sort of talked about things we've seen, haven't we, and experiences we've had. I don't know whether we've lost Rodrigo.
Yes, I think we've lost Rodrigo.
But it fascinates me, Karen. Oh, that's okay. I was just saying you and I are on the same page, aren't we? As Karen was talking about, collapsing time, going back down the timeline, and I said you and I both studied holographic kinetics over the years, and we've had some very interesting conversations on going back and exploring previous existences and looking at the Earth from a different perspective as well, from out in space, haven't we?
That's right.
So it's something that...
I remember... being on the table and forwarding space time.
Wow.
The connection's really bad quality at the moment.
Yes, you're
do you want me to add you back in, Rodrigo, and see if that helps?
Yeah.
That might be an idea.
That'd be good.
You'll be good? Okay. As I said, the internet's been absolutely shocking. It wants to start the video, so we're not starting the video. I don't know whether I've just touched something, guys. Sorry, that's better.
It was Karen. I've slapped her hand away.
No, did you? Okay. I'll see if I can add Rodrigo back in. There we go.
There's a box person at the bottom. I'm not sure if that's so you're having a lot of problems down there with the internet. Are they rolling out the NBN? Because I've been told down in New South Wales there's been a lot of problems with the rollout of in conjunction with the NBN, and that's what's causing their problems. And are you in Perth at the moment or Melbourne?
No, Rodrigo's north of Perth, and I'm in Victoria in Melbourne at the moment, because I moved, of course, a few weeks ago, and I've decided I'm not quite doing the gypsy thing. I'm probably being itinerant at the moment. I've got stuff in Brisbane, I've got stuff in country Victoria, I've got stuff in Melbourne, I've got stuff in the car. So I'm sort of in the process of looking for somewhere to say this is where I'm going to sleep for a while, which is quite exciting. And, you know, I'm at a friend's house who has internet, so I'm hooked up on the Wi-Fi. But even if I put my mobile broadband in, it just seems to be so slow. And even just getting the computer to start up, you know, when you go into the internet, is like takes forever. So I've thought it was might be my laptop, and I've done all sorts of cleansing programs and looked whether I had a virus or anything else, and everything says it's fine. So obviously it's not just me, it's what's happening around us. So
yeah, well, I know that there's a lot of activity with the NBN, and I know that it's affecting a lot of, well, I know in New South Wales, and there are a few hotspots up here. So it you may be right. You'll probably find they're rolling out quite a large section of the NBN at the moment in the area. Are you near, you're north of Melbourne, or are you near the city?
I'm about 50 kilometres out from the city, so heading towards Gippsland, but not down into Gippsland, so sort of just out from Berwick, that sort of area, sort of the foothills basically of the, you know, where the land starts rising and going uphill. We're just slightly on a hill. We're actually almost towards the top of a hill, not a big hill, but enough of a hill that, you know, you'd think that the signal would be fairly clear. But even the phone, the mobile phone's been a problem as well. So I've just, you know, I know I can often have an effect on things electrical, but I was listening to Rodrigo's show this morning and it was cutting in and out as well. So, you know, it wasn't like I was running the show. I was just tuned into Rodrigo's on air, online. So, and, you know, I've got everything else turned off. And
it could be Planet X. They say that's going to cause a lot of problems the closer it gets to Earth.
Yeah, well, that's interesting, isn't it? I mean, someone was, I was reading somewhere the other day that we'd lost our protective fields for a couple of hours or something, but there didn't seem to be a lot about it, just a couple of comments.
Well, no, they seem to play down anything major like Fukushima, don't they? So, I mean, the fact that...
Yes, for sure.
I mean, the fact that that's still pouring radiated water, I mean, this happened in March 2011, and it is still pouring radiated water into the Pacific Ocean is amazing. I mean, the fact that people aren't panicking, people are still eating Pacific seafood, and so, yeah, it's, you know, nothing surprises me. I mean, there's deformities now right up to Alaska. There was actually a conference about a year ago held in Alaska where they basically they got together and blamed Fukushima for the defects, the birth defects that are happening now in sea mammals. I mean, it's, and you don't hear any of this stuff. It's just amazing that it's kind of like ostrich sticking your head in the sand. You know, anything too that's going to rock the boat too much can't be out there. You know,
and a bit of misdirection going on there.
Yeah. As long as you get your our fill of the Kardashians, we will be fine, Sheila. So important to know how to get that pout. By the way, we have a delay.
We definitely have
a delay going on here on the system because we're expecting you to laugh, and it takes 4 seconds for you to do it. So if we don't answer straight away, there is definitely about a four-second delay.
I know we quite often have a delay when we're on air.
Earth to Sheila, are you still there, sweetie?
A four-second delay, maybe a little more, I think.
That was a long one. would you like
me? Yes, I am, but you're dropping in and out.
Oh, okay. Would you like me to tell you a little bit about the Ancient Arrow Project?
Please share. Yes.
Great. Okay. Now you'll be getting it in a delay, but let's go for it. In 1972 in New Mexico, a group of hikers discovered an unusual artifact and some pictographs within a canyon in quite a remote area of New Mexico. An expedition was organized by an archaeologist from the University of New Mexico, and that expedition exposed quite a few more artifacts. And all but one of those artifacts that was then discovered dated back to the 8th century. The artifact that wasn't dated was called, or was codenamed, the compass. And it appeared to be an intelligent form of technology as it was covered in strange symbols and hieroglyphs. Shortly after the discovery of the compass artifact, the US government, that's the NSA, took over the dig, and the project was then named Ancient Arrow. However, it became a failure, as they were unable to decode any of the symbols or the hieroglyphs actually on the compass itself. 21 years later, in 1994, a series of rock slides in the same area of the canyon in New Mexico opened up a whole new section of just slightly off from where the Ancient Arrow site had been. And it revealed this cavern really that went deep into the canyon walls. And inside this canyon, they discovered a system of tunnels and 23 distinct chambers that had been carved out of the rock by some kind of tool. Each chamber held a specific wall painting, pictograph, hieroglyphics, and more interestingly, some form of dormant alien technology. So that's 23 different chambers had all of these things in them. The Ancient Arrow project was then handed over to a group which not many people know about called ASIO, which is short for the Advanced Contact Intelligence Organization. And the ASIO's agenda is to research, assimilate, and replicate technologies or discoveries of an extraterrestrial origin. Isn't that interesting? Have you ever heard of that one, Sheila? ASIO?
I have, but it's sort of a memory somewhere in the back of my mind. I know there was a lot of stuff that was hidden or kept secret, wasn't there, over the years?
Yes.
You know, as soon as someone finds something interesting, it's all, no one's allowed near it, and the barbed wire and the men with guns go up kind of thing. And I think there's just so much that's coming to life now that we haven't been aware of. And I think we've lost Rodrigo again.
Poor Rodrigo.
I'll just see if I can add him back in.
Shall I keep going?
And this is where I think it's wonderful, Sharon Ann, with the columnists that you have, that you're actually sharing. Yes, please, a lot of this information, which is so important.
Well, I think the more we get out there, the more they can't suppress, I suppose. That's my theory on why I started the magazine. I mean, if we can actually get articles out there and we can start discussions between people, things like these projects, and these, to my mind, these secret projects are, they're the utmost thing that we should not be doing. We should be sharing this information. The people that should be investigating and doing this research should not be military based. I mean, the reality is, if a military organization goes in to do a dig to investigate it, they're really only interested in one thing, and that's getting a weapon out of it, really, or finding something that they can suppress if it's a weapon that can be used against us. Do you see what I mean? Whereas if you have people like the original archaeologist that went in to, to do the dig, actually doing that research instead, it will come out, the outcome of that will be something completely different. It won't be militarized. So that's what upsets me about all these secret projects that are created. I mean, and the US government, God, it's, I probably could run off 20, maybe even 30 different projects which they've been running over the last 50 years. And each one of them, it never has a happy outcome. It's they're always trying to pervert something or change the human body to do something that it doesn't actually do. You know, it's I mean, like we're all part of their projects. I mean, anyone that's been vaccinated is part of the project.
I was actually talking about this a few days ago. My daughter-in-law mentioned one of my granddaughters having pains in her legs, and I, because it's a family history on one side of brittle bone syndrome, and the doctor was saying, I mean, she's 17 this coming weekend. Oh, maybe she's got a, you know, a slight case of osteogenesis imperfecta. And I, knowing that, you know, two of my daughter-in-law's sisters were born with it, one's passed and the other one's in a wheelchair, you'd think it'd show up before 17 years. So I said to my daughter-in-law, you know, has she had any vaccinations lately? And I got the, you know, Mum, we love you and we know you don't believe in vaccinations, but yes, she's had everything and she's totally up to date. And she's just started working part-time school and in a centre for the intellectually and physically disabled. So, of course, she'd have to have, you know, all the local, sorry, not local, the current inoculations to, you know, be in that situation and actually working with people. And it's one of the things, Sharon Ann, you know, I didn't inoculate my children. My elder son's 48 this year. And growing up in a Western medical household, of course, I was the worst in the world because I didn't follow that medical pattern. But I believe it was actually the polio vaccination that started all my issues as a child. And we look at the things that are happening around the world, you know, talking to my girlfriend today that I'm staying with, and she was saying about, you know, the powers that be, if you like, wanting to decrease the population. I said, well, look at the programs. You've got Bill and Melinda Gates, you know, putting out vaccinations around the world that sterilize people and things like that. So we are programmed, you know, we are inoculated with all of these dreadful things. And nowadays in Australia especially, and I'm sure in the US as well, if you're in particular fields of employment like hospital, government, school, but even government offices, you don't get a choice. You have got to have the vaccinations.
Although you also have people like my husband that go and get the flu shot every year as well. I think he does it to spite me now, Sheila. he did it about 2 weeks ago, and he gets great delight telling me that he's been vaccinated. So I just tell him, well, that's, you've just taken a year off your life. More money for me to spend when you're dead.
Well, I know a few years ago, and I'm sure I've said it to you before, Sharon, and man I was doing a lot of work with here in Victoria, Romanian man, introduced me to a lady doctor in Romania over Skype to do some work. I don't know if you know, Karen, I work with cell memory and using sound programs, so and the energy fields of the body. So this was for this lady's parents, who were reasonably elderly, and both had what I would call cell malfunction and the Western world would call cancer. And I was looking at it, and because, you know, I use kinesiology to ask questions, and I'm intuitive psychic, if we like, as well. And it was like, something doesn't fit here. Something's not quite right. And I said to this lovely lady doctor, can you ask Mum and Dad, who didn't speak English, does anything come up in their mind when we ask them what happened? Did anything significant happen 25 years ago? And her father said, no, nothing I can think of. And then her mother said, oh, yes, that's when the whole village was enforceably vaccinated. And it was like, bingo, the flashing lights went off. Thank you, I can deal with that. I know where I'm going now. And we actually created a program to detox, if you like, the effects. It's not readily available, but if anyone would like a copy, please contact me. It's a sound program. So, you know, that's something I keep and share with people quite regularly, people who are interested, of course, but we don't know what, you know, what's going into these vaccinations. And I actually shared something the other day. A wonderful young friend of mine in Canada who was talking about nanotechnology. And, you know, if you're not going to let them vaccinate it into you, then they'll put it into what you eat. And, you know, the levels of heavy metals, for example, that are in so much of what we're consuming or being given as well. And just yesterday, we've had some family dramas. We had a death in the family, my son-in-law's uncle, and, you know, his Koori background, so I went to be supportive for the family. And my daughter had gone off the prescription drugs that the doctor believed that she should have some time ago. And, you know, even with everything that was going on, was doing really, really well. So when she told the doctor, he was absolutely horrified. And he actually wants her to go to the chemist twice a week and have to stand at the counter and physically take her medication. Now,
physically
stand at the counter
and physically stand at the counter and have the chemist hand her medication so that she can swallow it in their view to say that she's taken it.
Seriously?
Seriously, this is a country town in Victoria, and I said to her yesterday, last night on the phone, you are joking, aren't you? And she said, no, I'm not, Mum. He wants me to go to the chemist twice a week, and they will hand me my medication, and I have got to swallow it while I'm there. Now, you might as well put someone behind bars and say, we're going to, you know, give you this and you'll take it whether you like it or not.
So what's she going to do?
Not take it.
Good.
He played the guilt card of, you know, that my son-in-law's not well and he doesn't need to be worrying about her as well and she really needs to be on this medication and.
Sounds like that's disgusting. Sounds like a bully. He sounds like he's a bully.
Both guilt and bully, exactly. Yes.
Well, it's really interesting, Sheila, with all of the information that's coming out these days about, you know, vaccinations, even the chemtrails, and, you know, many people coming out with all of these conspiracy ideas and theories. Although what it really does assist people to just to wake up a little bit and just observe, you know, really observe what's going on. And hopefully they start to really inquire and begin to open their minds a little bit and just, you know, notice the children in the schools these days that diagnosed with all of the ADDs and the medications that that are being really pushed upon us, and also the, like we said about the vaccinations. It really does come down to the person and free will. But hopefully, you know, it does open people's minds and allows them to research and explore the different options, you know, that they have as far as alternative medications. And the work that I do, what is just really fascinates me when accessing the subconscious cause, and that's exactly what we do, have the person stop their conscious thoughts and go into a trance-like state and actually accesses their subconscious. And people do hold all of their answers. Go back to the cause of major illnesses or conditions, you know, in their life. And I really wanted to share a story with you tonight about a past client. And this really reflects this. This really reflects that we do hold all of our answers, especially to illnesses. So about 5 years ago, 5-6 years ago, for a couple of years there, I was taking volunteers for case studies. And I was offering free regressions for people with serious and life-threatening illnesses. And one of the ladies that approached me had a serious muscular dystrophy, and she had this all of her life, and she was quite functioning in the world. She could drive, but she had some limitations about, you know, grabbing a cup in her hand. It also affected the muscle in her jaw, and this restricted or gave her a speech impediment. So when I first met her and I was first speaking to her, you know, I had to really focus and ask her a few times, you know, what did she say, because it affected her speech. And so going into past lives, the first life that she went into, while she was running along, she's in a war zone, and she was a man, she had a gun, she saw jungle to the left, but it was this open field. And when I have people go into regression, it doesn't really matter what year or country, but we go into the trauma. We ask the subconscious to show them directly, where did this trauma begin, or where did this illness begin? And she saw that bombs are exploding around her, and there was one that exploded right in front of her, and this actually did kill her. It was fatal. And so what I do in my regression is have them go into a slow motion, like moments before the bomb went off, for instance, so that she could experience what was happening. And as you know, regression therapy, you're observing it. It's not like it's happening. It's not horrific, and it's not terribly fearful like it was happening there the first time. And so she was observing this, and her body was flung back. It did feel like she went into a million pieces, she's reported. Mm-hmm. And the last thought that went through her mind was, I will never recover from this. So this was a thought that impressed upon her subconscious. And we think that that was the previous life to this one now, according to a few other facts. So the idea that, and the realization that she did bring this trauma into this life, and she incarnated with severe muscular dystrophy, is a direct result of how our trauma impresses upon our subconscious. So with this lady in particular, we did about 3 or 4 regression therapies, which was about 2 hours each. And then after about the second one, so the third one, she comes along to her third session, and I was able to understand her speech a little more clearly. And I thought maybe I was just getting used to her her speech patterns. But she said that her friends had noticed an improvement in her speech patterns as well. And then by the fourth session, she was actually even putting on muscle weight in her cheekbones and around her collarbone. And she knew that it wasn't just putting on weight from overeating, because that would just collect on her inner stomach area. So we begin to see changes with her on a physical, a physical level. Yes, so this is why I'm totally fascinated with this work. So to go to the subconscious cause, whether this life or past lives, to anything that we have going on in our life today, and even serious illnesses. So this has been very fascinating with me in my life. So I wanted to share that story with you.
That's awesome. Thank you, Karen. And so many people, I think, just accept that, you know, we're here and this is life and it's happening, and get on with it. Mm-hmm. You know, I've said before, 20 years ago, I was sitting in a wheelchair. Doctors told me I would never walk again and I would die very soon. And I made a very conscious decision that that wasn't going to happen. So I've been walking for 20 years, and my sister, who has supposedly the same illness that I refuse to accept as mine, has been sitting in a wheelchair for 19 years. So basically, as I came out of one, she went into one. So the subconscious and to me, cell memory, it's such an important part of our life, and so much of the And you'd know using regression and hypnosis, so much of the programming that we take on, you know, in utero from childhood, and again, you know, as you're saying, past life, that we're programmed to, from my perspective, struggle to survive, to be lesser, to be a slave race, or a whole range of things. That's one of the things that I've been fascinated with for years. And I know, having spoken to Sharon Ann and some of the work she does and the research she does, there's so much more that we're able to access and achieve, isn't there? Given the right tools.
Definitely. Oh, and given the belief in ourselves, I think, as well. I mean, I tried remote viewing a couple of years ago. I did a lot of research into it and joined a few groups. And within, I think, about a six-week period, I was able to tell you what was... I was actually able to sketch things that were on a photograph that I hadn't actually seen that was hidden away. So I'm quite... I think a lot of things that we think are abilities or gifts aren't actually abilities or gifts. They're natural that we all have, but we've just had like the wool pulled over our eyes. We're actually quite dynamic beings, and we're really not living up to our potential.
Yes, I agree, absolutely.
I would totally agree. It's that dumbed down, isn't it? As Karen was saying, you know, ADD and autism are a huge passion of mine. I create programs, creative programs over the years. I'm working on a new series to release shortly. And it's getting to the stage now where it's not that you take your child to the doctor and they say they've got ADD, which I don't believe exists. But teachers are saying, your child's got ADD, get them to the doctor and get them put on medication. Yes. And it's like, who made the teacher, you know, able to diagnose what's wrong with the child? And, you know, the other thing, there was a really interesting, I can't remember exactly what it said, but a little post on Facebook, I copied it yesterday or the day before. But it said, you know, children have this inquiring mind, so we close them in the classroom. And they learn by exploring, so we make them learn by rote. And, you know, we're stifling them from that very, very early access into the whole school, but not even just into the school situation. You know, I've got lots of grandchildren, Karen, so I've been visiting some of them recently. I tend to be the mysterious grandmother and just turn up occasionally. And you watch the fact that in one of my children's house, there is an enormous television on the lounge room wall, and there's a television in every bedroom. So I put a one-year-old, 13-month-old, to bed the other night, and her sister said to me, oh, she might be crying because she doesn't like what's on TV. Do you want me to go and change the channel for her? You know, it was a movie or something. And I said, she's 13 months old. No, she doesn't need TV to go to bed with. But so much that comes through, things like, you know, television programs and movies.
Child abuse. You don't, children under three shouldn't be in front of any TV. That's child abuse. That's just that's giving over.
No, I don't think they should either.
It's interesting. Today I've been today I've been editing my second book, and I've written, I was inspired to write about the great disconnect in humanity. And it's even started as early as childcare. The disconnect, you know, and we come home, people are on their phones, we go online, and there's a real disconnect within our families, within the community. And this disconnection is from ourselves and from our deeper emotions as well. And it's become the norm, which is, it's pretty sad. I mean, thinking back to when I was a child, I probably could have been diagnosed one of the ADDs as well. But growing up incredibly sensitive, I was feeling lots of people in my room at night, not understanding that I was a natural born medium. And it took me until my early 20s to deeply understand what that meant. And, you know, I see a lot of empaths and deeply sensitive people in the world that, you know, found their coping mechanisms. And it's actually a desensitization and a numbing of our emotions is what happens. So a lot of people that come to me actually have emotional breakdowns, which I call an emotional breakthrough. Some turn to medication to numb these emotions. And I think that's what, you know, the medication does to the children in schools, to allow them to fit into a system that really is quite archaic when you think about it.
Well, it's a kind of a prison. I mean, I hated school. Couldn't wait to leave.
Me too.
Hated it with a passion.
Well, it's very flawed, isn't it?
Well, yes, unless you've got a photographic memory, you know, or the recall of, you know.
It's good to see some alternative schools popping up, though. I've heard some really great things about...
Biz down here. Oh, we've got one very close to us. Strangely enough, Sheila, Karen and I live in the same suburb.
Yes.
How's that?
Really?
How could you pick that?
That's awesome.
I know.
Mm. So, I reckon that's cool.
Yeah, there is a school that's no,
we'll be close. We'll be going to a break in a moment, or in the next couple of minutes. So if you keep the thought when we do that, whatever we were talking about, and we get about 6 minutes break, guys. So we'll be definitely coming back. But the other thing on the whole child abuse thing that I was complaining about yesterday is diet drinks. You know, how many parents do you see putting Diet Coke or Coke Zero in baby bottles?
Seriously, in a baby's bottle?
In baby's bottles. And there was an article a week or so ago from the US. It was actually a post on Facebook, and I'm pretty sure I shared it on my page, that they talk about Mountain Dew mouth. And we'll be back after the break.
Did you ever feel that things were not quite right? That everything was just ever so slightly askew?
Do you have, to paraphrase Morpheus, a splinter in your mind?
If you're interested in hearing the latest information about UFOs, the paranormal,
ancient cultures and structures,
monatomic elements,
longevity,
fantastic discoveries in science,
download it to your brain,
then tune in to us. Hi, I'm Dave.
And I'm Mackie.
And we are Shiny Side Out, Sundays 2 to 4 a.m. Eastern. See you then.
Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. You don't need to expect us. We're already here.
And this is Rocco.
And the Bo and Rocco Show is here to offer insight into legal and lawful remedies. Our goal is to remain free and help others remain free in an ever-increasing police-like state. With the help of our guests, we try to answer questions such as what went wrong and what can we do about it.
So tune into Revolution Radio at www.freedomslips.com Wednesday nights, 10 to 12 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, to listen to the Bo and Rocco Show.
You don't need to expect us.
We're already here.
Revolution Radio.
This is the people's war. It is our war. We are the fighters. Fight it then. Fight it with all that is in us. And may God defend the right.
Warning! Warning!
We've got to stop them! They're going to kill us all!
See how the trouble you've started?
Be they the government, be they industry, be they organized labor, be they anyone, or human beings!
Time when the operation of the machine becomes so odious, makes you so sick at heart, that you can't take part, you can't even passively take part, and you've got to put your bodies upon the gears and upon the wheels, upon the levers, upon all the apparatus, and you've got to make it stop, and you've got to win the day to the people who run it, to the people who own it, that unless you're free, the machine will be prevented from working.
Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com, the number one listener-supported talk radio station, throwing ourselves upon the gears of the machine. Revolution Radio, where information never sleeps.
You call down the thunder, well now you've got it.
Enter into a world unseen on Raven Star's Witching Hour. You will encounter eclectic topics from the realm of spirit brought into our matrix of truth. With your host, the Solaris Blue Raven, Solaris will bring you an array of unique guests covering topics from ghostly spirits to amazing anomalies, covert technology, UFOs, and shadowy global events.
And that's right here at Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, Saturdays, midnight till 2 a.m. Eastern Time. Revolution Radio, where information never sleeps.
Let the magic rise.
Your data safe? Do you have the necessary information to assist you in confidently living through just about any survival situation? In survival, in gardening, off-grid living, medical knowledge, or even natural or man-made EMPs on your list of personal concerns? Do you have your documents and your personal information in a safe place in your hands where you know where it is? Well, check out our preloaded EMP-proof thumb drive. Over 3 gigs of survival documents and how-tos, plus the USDA offline food preservation website, and much, much more, including a surprise bonus we just can't tell you about here. With plenty of room left over to store your most important documents. Imagine if a megavirus or a computer failure took out your bank, or all the banks for that matter. Are your banking records safe in your hands? So when they get things fixed and repaired, you can say, hey, look, this is what I had. You have it. I want it back. Is your personal data safe? Family records, addresses, phone numbers? Squeeze on over to freedomslips.com. Yes, that's www.freedomslips.com. Click the banner on the homepage for the EMP-proof bullet drive to get the full scoop of everything that we offer. So, folks, keep your data safe for your peace of mind. Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com. You don't need to expect us. We're already here.
Enjoy your
Give me no fries, I got an empty box.
Would you like another?
Extra big ass fries!
I said I didn't get any.
Thank you, your account has been charged. Your balance is zero. Please what? Come back when you can afford to make
no,
the purchase.
No, no!
I'm sorry you
Come
have
on!
Trouble.
My
I'm
kids
sorry
are starving!
Thank you for tuning in to Revolution Radio. Here at Revolution Radio, we believe in freedom of ideas, freedom of speech, but above all, we believe in freedom of existence through self-reliance. This station is 100% listener-supported, and as a fundraising promotion, I have a kick-ass free gift for a $100 donation. 35,000 seeds. 25 years in the freezer, long-term storable 54 different varieties. So if food prices go crazy,
Yeah, it's the fan art. If you just want to save tons of money every year by creating your own food like I do, grab our seed pack specials. Just look for the banner on the homepage at freedomslips.com. Don't be a statistic. Don't be part of the problem. Be part of the solution. We need, as humans, to start taking care of ourselves and not depending on the megacorps to provide unhealthy, nasty food. Included in this package is also a DVD with 900 survival and off-grid living documents on the offline home canning how to do everything website, all in a DVD. So when you're growing all that food, you know how to can it, store it, preserve it, etc. with all these documents. So thank you for tuning in to Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. I hope you will pick up this package and start learning to be free. Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps and freedom is one seed that needs to be planted.
The opinions expressed on this radio station, its programs, and its website by the hosts, guests, and call-in listeners or chatters are solely the opinions of the original source who expressed them. They do not necessarily represent the opinions of Revolution Radio and freedomslips.com, its staff or affiliates.
You're listening to Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, 100% listener-supported radio, and now we return you to your host.
Good evening, you're with Sheila Kennedy and welcome to the 1%. And we're with Revolution Radio at freedomslips.com. And Revolution Radio is the number one 100% listener-supported radio station, bringing tonight's show to you. So because we're listener-supported, we rely on the wonderful people who tune into our show and who donate to keep us online. So you can access our store on the Revolution Radio website. We have a chat room where you can connect with some wonderful people around the world, and that's free, of course. And we have the archives where, for a very low cost, about the price of a cup of coffee, $4.95 a month, you can access the archives of all of the shows. And we have more than 90 hosts currently on Revolution Radio. So there's a lot of shows, a lot of interesting topics and conversations. So if you can afford to donate, we really do appreciate you, a little or a lot. And I know that Nighthawk, who runs Revolution Radio, at the moment is working on creating a, I'm not quite sure what it is, but a way of us not being reliant on the actual physical electrical grid. So like a battery system that will run for about 8 hours, so that if the electricity company goes down, we can actually still keep running the show. So we're working hard on raising a little bit more than our normal monthly amount of money we need to keep the station running to actually be able to have our own power source. So that's all exciting. And if you can afford to donate, there's a donate button on the website, or if you're in the chat room, on the left-hand side down the bottom, and we do appreciate you. If you're wanting to call in to listen, 605-562-4199, or 605, that's Studio A, Studio B, 605-562-4200. Now, this is our last Thursday of the month roundtable, and Sharon and Rowland of the Oddities eClub magazine and author of the Crystal Channelers series, I'm still waiting for book four, Sharon, is with me each. I just keep reminding her, you see, I've read three, so now I need the fourth one. And I know she's a busy lady, so I'm being a little bit patient, but not very much. I just keep pushing every month that I still haven't seen that one yet. Sharon comes on regularly and invites amazing guests. So you can find Sharon, Sharon Ann, on Facebook. You can also find her on her website, and I have just put her links in the chat room, but we'll share them in a moment. And Karen Langford is our guest tonight, an amazing lady from Brisbane in Australia. I've just shared a link to Karen's book, The Wisdom of Your Soul, A Guide to Self-Empowerment, and that's available at www.karenlangford.com.au. And I know Karen's working on another book at the moment, so one to look out for. So Karen's had a pretty amazing life. If you didn't hear the first part, she offers regression as a hypnotherapist. She's a rebirther, clairvoyant medium, author, as we said, and an ET experiencer. So you can connect with Karen via her website, and she offers Skype sessions as well. So that's an amazing way, if you're not in the area that Karen lives in, that you can actually connect with her. So welcome back, Sharon Ann and Karen. Great to have you both with me. And always look forward to talking about the different things in life. And we were talking just as we went to the break. Yes, you're still there.
Yes, we're still here.
We seem to still have that lag, don't we?
Oh, yeah.
You're still there. That's good. Rodrigo dropped out. He said was lagging his end, and he thought it might help if he didn't come back in, but it doesn't seem to have made much difference at all. So I'm not quite sure what's going on. But we were talking about, and I shared a couple of links, the food additives and things like that that affect children, and especially, you know, things like all the aspartame that has such a horrible effect on our body in diet drinks. And you see so many children, and as I said, even babies with it in bottles. I think it's pretty dreadful stuff at the best of times. But it's also part of that television education, isn't it? This is the way to go. This is the you know, the cool thing to have. Or, you know, the number of people I see with those energy drinks that I think are pretty dreadful.
Well, how many heart attacks have they brought on, eh? I mean the mothers and...
Pretty right, yes.
What's the ingredient? Aspartame?
Good. Guarana? Is it guarana?
Aspartame.
Oh, aspartame. Yeah.
Guarana, yes.
Yeah. The guarana is, I think, the one that revs up and the metabolism going really fast.
You know, there's
was it?
In the diet drinks, yes. Yeah. Mm. And you see so many people, you know, because you can buy it in supermarkets by the package. You don't just... People aren't just buying one can, you know, you see them loading it in their trolley in the 6 or 10 or 12 or whatever happens to be in the package. And you think, what on earth are you doing to yourself? So pretty dreadful stuff. So you were saying, Karen, you're editing a second book?
Yes. My first book is called The Wisdom of Your Soul.
He's forgotten the name of a book.
The Wisdom of Your Soul.
A Guide to Self-Empowerment.
Yes, thank you very much.
Thank God you're on the ball.
And so my second book is a carry-on, and it's called The Alchemy of Your Soul. So I explore more of the hypnotherapy session or techniques to allow people to access the subconscious reason for those triggers, and you know, those people that constantly trigger us in our lives, our partners, our parents, boss, co-workers, to actually to find the subconscious trigger. I also share ways to access your intuition and to dialogue with your intuition on a daily moment-to-moment base. So, and being able to step forward and create your life. And this is about living in a space of continual positive expectancy. And you've heard the expression, expect the best. So when you live and learn how to be in a positive state, this will help you to create more positive experiences. So I even talk about biblical sayings, and I'm sure a lot of people like me were confused going to Sunday school as a kid. You know, what does this mean? What do these sayings in the Bible mean, and how can I relate them to my life? So I talk a little bit about some biblical sayings, like you know, you reap what you sow, allows you to take responsibility for what you are projecting out into the world on a conscious level and a subconscious level. So this is how we are creating our reality. And probably heard of that saying before. Our thoughts, words, and actions are continually creating our reality. So there's many hypnotherapy techniques that I share in my book, and manifesting in the world. Yes, quite interesting stuff.
Sounds good. We'll be looking out for that one. And as I said, you can find Karen's The Wisdom of Your Soul, A Guide to Self-Empowerment at www.karenlangford.com.au. So I'll be going to have a look at that myself. That all sounds very interesting. And how are you going, book-wise, Sharon? And I'm harassing you, I know.
Well, I wrote a play a couple of years ago called The X Blogs, and it's about a blogger who, and it's set in three acts, and in each act she has a boyfriend and something happens to them. They always end up disappearing, hence the name The X Blogs. And so I'm actually working on that at the moment, turning that into a book and maybe into an animation. So that's the next thing on the agenda. So I'm
fantastic.
I just have to be in the right mood before I get back to the crystal channelers.
I can understand that.
As you know, that there was, I also did a lot of channeling on that book, which is and I'm not sure. Like I did actually channel the fourth book, like the plot line of it. So I have that.
Yep.
So I could just sit down and write it. Actually, it's just but because that series was so special, I'm now actually thinking I need to put it into a different medium. So I was going to do the X-Blogs as an animation or a comic series. And then if that worked out well, I was then going to take the first book of the Crystal Channelers and see if I could do the same with it. So mostly because the book kicks off in 2018 when things start to happen. So, and because I did all that channeling of those events, I think it would be great to actually launch like an animated version of the books during the same timeline. So I've actually followed the timeline.
That sounds incredible, I think, yeah.
Yeah, and it would be wonderful if I was channeling actual event, you know what I mean? So as I put it out. Mm.
And didn't you channel that when you were a teenager?
I started writing that series through Dream when I was 13. Just after I'd emigrated out to Australia from England. But the actual channeling was between 2008 and 2011. So there was a good, yeah. So and that was quite an experience. Although I don't channel the same way that Karen channels. In fact, I don't even know if I do. What I did basically was I think I connected to the Akashic record of information, because a lot of the information that went into my books, I wrote about them, and then it wasn't till I started doing research a year or so later that I realized a lot of the information in my books was actually historical, and I hadn't done that. So there was a lot of epiphanies, and there was a lot of characters that I'd have a name which sounded very similar to an actual historical figure. So there was I had a lot of that along the way. So I knew I was channeling from a pure source of some information. So that's why I've got this idea about running like an animated series over that timeline, or maybe a few months prior to the timeline, so people can read it, and then if things actually start happening like as in the books, it would be great.
That'd be fantastic. I'm looking forward to that. Channeling, Karen, I know Sharon and I have talked about it before. It's not a word I've ever liked, but I do. So I usually say things are gifted or downloaded to me. When did you, do you have a memory of when you started channeling, your awareness of information coming through to you?
Yes, I consciously put my intention to channel about 4 years ago. And I had a friend help me. She's also a hypnotherapist and past life regression therapist. And I would probably liken it very much to mediumship, because, and it felt like the evolution for me, the next step for me, from mediumship. So what I found with mediumship is that when you begin, okay, so in meditation, you know about stopping the left brain thoughts, stopping thoughts of the future or the past, and just allowing yourself to be in the moment. So meditation is about just finding and feeling that peace in the moment, okay? So the more that you meditate and go deeper into that space, it seems to me to open up this portal. Now, and the longer that I have done this over the years, the easier it is and quicker it is for me to be able to go into that deep space, that deep, deep, relaxed place in myself. So some might call it a deep hypnotic state. I can put myself in that pretty quickly, within about 3 to 5 seconds now.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was putting, about 4 years ago, it was putting my intention that I had seen a couple of other people, I'd read about and seen them in actual channeling events in person. And I was very fascinated with it at that time. And my friend did guide me into a deep meditation this day, and I put my intention to be a channel. And I wanted to channel an ascended master that would choose me, that would fit their wisdom, fit me in some way. So we set the intention. She guided me into a deep meditation to meet with the ascended masters. And who come forward was Lord Kuthumi. And I didn't even know who he was. I read up about him after the session. And then when we went to actually put the intention and do the channeling, we recorded it. And I remember I had my eyes closed and I was in a very relaxed state. And just a few words come forward in my mind. And I'm waiting and I'm waiting for more. And I realized I had to say the two words, and it was welcome, welcome, because it just kept playing over and over in my mind until I said it. And then I said a few more words come forward, and I said them, and then about three more, and so forth and so forth. And when I was listening to the recording later and I was typing it up, I realized there was a message here. There was actually some amazing information. So just as I had discovered mediumship, you know, I did study with a few different mediums to define it and to hone what my gifts were and how it could come through me. It was really the setting of the intention that is so important. So mediumship, to give you an example with mediumship, I'm clairsentient, highly clairsentient. I can feel the person when they blend their energy with me. I can feel what part of their body that they passed, you know, through illness or whatever. And that's, mm-hmm. and I learned how to read the signs of how it come through. And then I saw other mediums that could get names and addresses and information like that. And I decided one day, well, I want names to come forward. And they started to come forward with names. So it was setting the intention, but just allowing yourself to go into that place with no thoughts, no judgments, no second guessing what's coming through. And that's always, you know, a challenge for me to just let go of those self-doubts and just, because it comes through so clearly and simply. And I think we attach so much to mediumship and channeling, but it's actually, you're in a state, such a deeply relaxed state, that you allow the information to connect and to come through you. You act like a channel. I found that I was taking on the mannerisms, and my voice changed when Lord Kathumi was coming forward. So it was quite interesting to experience that. I was always in a deep, relaxed state and of no thoughts. And I was observing this, being a light trans channel. I am also fascinated with the deep trance channeling, where, you know, some come have the experience and then they wake up and they don't know what they've even said. So that's very fascinating to me, and that feels like the next level of channeling.
I love Edgar Cayce personally, the Sleeping Prophet. I mean, what the most awesome way to read a book? You just put it under your pillow and go to sleep. That's fantastic stuff. I had no idea what a pivotal figure he was. I mean, this is a guy that created the whole concept of meditation, as well as the age, you know, new age, the phrase new age. I think a lot of mediums, a lot of new age mediums probably don't even realize what he's about sometimes. And when I've spoken to them, and I just think, how can you not know this pivotal figure, you know, in what you did, what you're supposedly, I mean, he was the original prophet, wasn't he?
He was. And to go back to what Karen was saying before about the Bible, as you were talking, Karen, I had the thought, the image of ask and it shall be given, seek and you shall find.
Yes.
You know, it very much is that, isn't it? When we're ready and we're open and we have that intention, that's what we want to do. Quite often it can be, you know, surprising. I often have said to people over the years, you know, be careful what you ask for, because you just might get it.
Yeah.
exactly.
It's one of my favorite phrases.
A bit tongue-in-cheek, I must admit.
Exactly. And I'm sure, like you, like myself, create a visualization with a book that first book I read was in the 80s. What's her name? Anyway, it'll come to me. Create a visualization, Shakti Gawain.
Yes.
And
yes.
Many have read that book. In the 80s, and it truly is that simple. I mean, one of the first things that Kathumi said to the, I did some public channelings here in Brisbane and the Gold Coast, and one of the first things he said one night, it felt like he was going a bit mad at people, not that he had any emotion, but he said, you must understand that your thoughts, words and actions are continually creating your reality. And when I read that back, and I was typing it up and I read it back, it went over my head. I couldn't really grasp what he meant by that. And in some of the channelings, he also would include a little guided meditation. So as you could imagine, I, you know, got a lot of from those channel sessions, and they are going into a book.
Fantastic.
Complete one day. But one of the things that he added to that topic of creative visualization. So we all know Shakti Gawain talked about visualization, and also adding that feeling of having that you are desiring in your life. And Kathumi also went over this, and he also took it one step further and had us focus on the creative energy from our lower two chakras. And bringing that, using that untapped source of energy within our own bodies. So that was a very interesting interesting information that come forward in one of the channelings. Kathumi.
I'm just trying to think, Joshua David Stone, I think the I Am University. He talked a lot about the Lord Kathumi, didn't he, in his books?
Oh, well, it's interesting. I'm tend to be a bit slow about studying, you know, and finding out all of these different people. And
what's his name? I'll Google
what they've written.
Joshua David Stone. He passed away some years ago. He wrote a series of, I think one's called the Ascension Manual. There's a number of them. I recall reading them in probably around 2007, 2008. My ex-husband was a great follower of Joshua David Stone. He talks about there being 336 chakras, because it's when I questioned why Trevor believed there were 336 chakras, and he said because Joshua David Stone said so. So my question was, well, have you ever asked? Do you know how many there actually are? And continued on from there. But yes, in a fair bit of his writings, his books, there's quite a number of them. He talks a lot about the Lord Kasumi. So it's a familiar name, yes. So, and it's an interesting process, isn't it, Karen? From what you're saying about how quickly you go into an altered state, you're probably reaching the delta level very quickly that not a lot of people do. Having, I've been a hypnotist for many years, and my ex-partner was my hypnosis trainer. I refer to him as the mad hypnotist. And he was quite fascinated when he first met me that, like you, I could go into that altered state very, very quickly, whereas other people will take time to sort of wind down and, you know, calm, quiet the mind and let that peaceful state take over. So it's, and again with voice channeling, I watched a lady up on the Sunshine Coast some years ago. I think she was channeling Red Cloud, and her description of it was like she stepped into one half of her body and he fitted into the other half. So, you know, that energy coming through.
That's a good description. And
well, I thought it was at the time, you know, because someone was asking her, how do you do this? And, you know, we've got Esther and Jerry Hicks with Abraham and so on, you know. So everyone's going to do it differently. It's a very personal experience, I think. You know, and especially having three people having a chat who all channel, and I'm sure we all channel differently. So as Sharon Ann was saying, you know, with the books, the Crystal Channelers books and her channeling. So it's not everybody that actually talks about channeling either, is it? It's not a, you know, there's a lot of books out there and a lot of people, but in general conversation, you don't always hear a lot about people who channel.
No, it's kind of the next step is the loony bin, Sheila, when you start.
Yeah, exactly.
Well, you really don't want to discuss that you're hearing voices either. That's not a good sign either.
It makes me feel compassion.
Well, I remember, Karen.
It makes me feel a lot of compassion.
Sorry, I missed that bit.
Oh, I feel a lot of compassion for some that, you know, are in mental institutions, because when you begin to go and explore these deeper levels, you know, I'll admit that sometimes I was just losing my grip a little bit on the reality. But, you know, and it is what I wanted to say before when you talked about Edgar Cayce, but Einstein, actually, I was reading a lot of information about how Einstein would go, and he didn't use the word meditation, but he would have these experiences where he went into the deeper parts of his mind and experienced, and it was interesting that he brought through a lot of his theories in the last year of his life. I was reading a really interesting some information about him, and I believe that he probably didn't talk too much about it, because that he didn't certainly want to discredit things that he did bring through to you know, to help humanity. But I believe he was channeling, having these experiences and tapping into this, you know, into our subconscious, our intuition, soul, wisdom, whatever you want to call it. I call it left brain, right brain. And with that said, a few years ago, I felt like Kathumi stepped back a little bit. It was almost like, now you've got to do it yourself. And this is many times people will experience guides to assist them. And even, you know, psychics these days say that my guides are telling me this, my guides are, or your guides. Are, and I've never really experienced a guide in my life. But
really?
No, I've never.
I can't get rid of mine.
I've never experienced guides, but I've connected deeply with loved ones in spirit.
I'd like mine to go away occasionally.
But your intuition and that direct connection to source, I believe, is you know, is what we can uncover in the right brain. if we allow and go deep enough. Now, sometimes, you know, people need to think that there is a guide or someone there talking to them, and perhaps it will present that way. I mean, Esther Hicks has even said that she calls it all that is.
Mm-hmm.
I'm pretty sure it was Esther Hicks, all that is. If you want a name, I will give you this name. So it's for us to understand, to be able to understand the information coming through so that we can effectively share that information or use that information in our life. And that's the real challenge, is to be able to connect with it and use it to assist us in our life.
I just Googled Master
Confucius. And so many times, I think. Sorry, Sharon?
I just Googled Master Kafumi. I'll just put in the link for you so you can go check him out. It's a nice picture.
Thank you. So many times children who are very open to, you know, messages and channelings and so on, get told, you know, you've got an overactive imagination, or, you know, in my instance, don't eat biscuits before you go to bed, you're going to have nightmares. And I think it's sad that young people especially get closed down. I remember my grandmother saying to me when I was very young, Karen, she used to take me along to the spiritualist church with her on the weekend when I was a very small child. And on the way home, this was in the UK, she'd be saying to me, now, you won't be telling your mam now, will we, Sheila Ram? And she explained to me quite young that there were some people that you couldn't talk to, and there was some things that, you know, you couldn't actually share. My grandmother was Welsh and psychic and read the tea leaves. It was an amazing influence in my life, and died when I was far too young, although she still walks with me every day. It's a wonderful experience. But people are much more open, because I just look like a sweet little old lady. I'm actually much older than I look, is what I tell people. So I've been around for a long time. And basically had communication with spirit from being very, very young. So to me it was very normal and very natural, and I didn't realize that other people didn't have it. And I think this is where a lot of people get shut down, because they say things and the people look at them more, you know, the voices in the head and the men in white coats, basically. So we learn, not me, because I'm out there talking about it, but and so are the both of you, Sharon and Karen. But a lot of people close down, I think, that channeling or that intuition or that connection that is so natural to all of us, but, you know, we're often frightened by it, or other people around us, I think, are frightened by it.
Well, this week I found the perfect comeback for that. If you meet somebody with a closed mind, Sheila, it just popped up. I think I was in LinkedIn or something, and I thought, oh my god, that's what I'm going to say from now on whenever I hit this. And it was, I'd rather have a mind open to awe than closed by belief. And I just thought,
I like that. Yes,
it just summed it up perfectly. Mm-hmm. And I mean, that's all you'd have to say to kind of, you know, and then to move on, you know, to end whatever discussion or whatever ridicule that was about to happen, you know. But, I mean, sadly, this is, it's 2016, you know, something like 10% of the population of Earth, which is a lot of people, have had
contact. That just went very almost like you were stuttering, obviously.
So, oh, we're probably, I thought we were actually in real time then.
Mm.
Can you hear us, yeah?
Yes.
Oh, good. So you just think.
How many of them actually will, you know, publicly recognize that, I guess, too?
Well, yes. You just got to get to the point.
Yeah, you're breaking up there for a moment, but hopefully the recording will be fine.
Basically, people have to get to a point in their own lives where they
understand. So when you think about that, Sharon Ann, you're saying, you know, 10% have had contact.
Have had a contact of some type, and pretty much you have to, as a person, get to a point in your life where you know yourself, And when you get to that point, it doesn't matter who's next to you, that you can pretty much say anything about what you know is truth, what and share your truth. I mean, the way I do it is, if I know the person well, I will just speak my truth. And that's what I've come to know is truth. Like the encounters I've had, I'm happy to discuss with people like yourself and with Karen. But if I'm in a mixed setting and there are a lot of muggles around, I don't discuss things like this. I let them talk. I listen to what they have to say. And I treat it more as a counselling session, you know, because those people all have problems. Have you not noticed? They're not very happy, the norm, you know, the norms out there.
Well, yes, I know what you mean. I decided about 5 years ago, I came out of the closet on Facebook about being a medium, psychic medium. And I told my partner, because I actually didn't do readings for a long time. I just shut it down because I just wasn't interested. A bit too scary. But then I just decided, you know what? I'm going to stop fitting into other people's lives.
Yeah.
So I'm just going to stop fitting into society and talking about everything that seems to be the norm. And I started talking about my interest and being a psychic medium and now recently being an ET experiencer. And I'll tell you what happens. An interesting thing happens. Either the people share something of an experience, slightly similar experience, or they change the subject. So you know right away who will join you there in your truth and who chooses not to. And you know what? That's okay. You tend to have some people fall out of your life, but I tell you what, you make room for ones that have similar interests. Mm.
I mean, when I went to Paracom last year, I walked in there and I had this amazing automatic sense of community, and I haven't felt that ever. And I remember I walked in and people just come up and talk to you, and the first thing they were saying is, oh, have you actually had the experience of the paranormal and all the things that, you know, you don't normally get asked. And the first couple of hours on the Friday night where it kicks off with a bit of a drink session at the bar. And, you know, I think after about 2 or 3 hours, we all knew that, you know, that was our tribe. You know, we finally found the community, the place where no one's going to judge us. And I think that's what it comes down to with a lot of people. It's, am I going to be judged? And when you don't give a hoot about what other people say, then judgment means nothing to you. Mm-hmm. And as I said, I think that's when you know your own truth. I mean, I've had discussions with people that basically say, you know, to me, oh, you haven't had experiences with ETs. And I just said, do you believe in God? You know, if they're wearing a cross, and they'll say, oh, yes, I believe in God. And I said, well, I know there are ETs because I've had that experience. I've had telepathic contact with them. Have you had telepathic contact with God? And by the end of the discussion, they'll look at me and I'll say, now, out of the two of us, only one of us has actually had a contact experience here with their God or the person, and that's me. So how stupid are you? And that's where it comes to a lot of the time, Sheila, with people. They don't realize that when they're being mean and they're being condescending, they themselves don't even have the, you know, 10% of the proof that I have, you know, or my truth. And I find that ridiculous personally, and I find that insulting, that they're quite happy to, you know, make me feel bad or make me feel silly or as a bit of a Looney Tunes, but they're also very happy to leave the table clutching their cross. You know, it's hypocritical and it's illogical in a way. Yes. You know. But Karen's nicer than
I posted this morning.
Karen would have something nicer to say.
Sorry, we're breaking up again.
I find a lot of my metaphysical friends like yourself, Sheila and Karen, you have a very nice way of delivering things to people, which I could learn a lot from. Whereas my delivery is quite abrupt, I think.
Oh, I have a friend that refers to her friends as her 3D friends and her 4D friends.
That's, yes. Is that worse than muggle? I don't know. I got muggle from Harry Potter being non-magical.
I like that.
Because I think our world is full of magic, full of wonder and full of awe. That's why I think muggle fits better. Mm. So who wouldn't want to imagine the things that we live with, you know? That's what I don't understand a lot with when I'm talking to somebody. Why would you prefer to have that life, you know, when you could be in our world, you know? That's what I don't understand, Sheila. Can you shed some light on it?
Well, it's interesting, Sharon, and I posted the Tonight Show on my Facebook page, and Laura Lee, who does a lot of work for Revolution Radio, posted on the Revolution Radio page, and I found that somebody posted below my post saying, "Burn her, she's a witch." So because I'd posted the three of us, I'm not sure which one of us was the witch, but there you go.
Definitely a muggle.
And I quite often tell people they've actually spelled it wrong. It's spelled with a B, not a W, when they're talking about me.
Oh, you know, go on.
And so I ignored it. And then Facebook sent me a message.
Saying what?
So Facebook sent me a message saying someone's posted on your timeline and are you aware that you can go into your security settings and change it? And I thought, no, I'm not taking it off. If that's someone's opinion of you or Karen or I, then obviously they've got a problem and it's not our problem.
Well, you know, years ago things like that would really hurt me and upset me, but my advice, go underneath that comment or even the reply to that particular person and go, ha 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 ha.
Or trouble, boil in trouble. Like that.
I would laugh it off these days. I see the humour in it. So
I think I actually blocked that person, so I can't see it anymore.
Mm. Okay.
Because as soon as I see stuff like that, I just think, oh, unnecessary. So,
yes.
Mm. We are a free will planet to believe what we want to believe.
Or block whoever we want to block.
Yes, exactly.
So who do you think's the bigger witch, you, me, or Karen?
Oh, I think it'd be a bit of a toss-up, wouldn't it?
What do you think?
Well, there can only be one wicked witch of the West. Do you want that? We live in West Brisbane. Do you want that title?
Well, if it's the Wicked Witch of the West, she actually ended up being good. So, well, actually, no, I think it might be you, Sheila, because it is your photo on the post. So I think
isn't it? Yeah.
I think you've got the title, sweetie. So I think.
Oh, well, it fits with my children telling me I don't actually need a car. I just need to get the Kickstarter fixed on my broom.
Exactly. So there you go. So look, you know, as I said, there's always going to be people out there that will give their 2 cents worth. You just got to rise above it, really, or, you know, do what I do and just well, basically block them or remove them from the environment, you know, if you can. Somebody will eventually.
Well, it's not someone who's a friend of mine. They're not connected with me in any way. Oh, that I know of, but they've just posted on the link. So
I blocked them and I didn't recognize them, so they must have just they must have just been attached to one of us. Did you share it to me?
I think they've possibly come through Revolution Radio, because they seem, when I click, seem to have some people, you know, on their friends list who are part of the radio station. So I put it down to maybe someone's being funny, or, you know, that's their weird sense of humour, or maybe I've offended someone in some way, and if I have, also be it, that's their problem. Nobody asked them to look at my post, did they?
No, and my favourite saying is build a bridge and walk over it.
Yes, absolutely. So it's fascinating for me, and it's also wonderful to share with like-minded people, obviously, and know that there are people. It's actually in the middle of the probably nearly 6 a.m. in parts of the U.S., Karen, at the moment, and, you know, fairly early in the morning in the U.K., but we have a lot of listeners who actually stay up to listen to the shows, and a lot of people into the archives and so on. So it's great to be able to share people and share information. So I really do appreciate Sharon Ann inviting you and you coming along and being on air. That's fantastic. And I hope you'll come back and share with us again. And especially when you put your new book out, so we can talk about that. That would be awesome. Because to me it is about sharing information, sharing knowledge.
Yes, I would love to come and join you again. I have given myself a date of my birthday, June 16th, this year, and I'm in deep editing mode right now. So when I set my intention to something is usually when I'll finish things.
Now, Sheila, did you get my email? I've asked for next month, my conspiracist. That's a combination of conspiracy theorists, by the way. Rob Newitt from the magazine to come on to the next session with us. I thought you might like that, a bit of controversy.
That sounds awesome, yes.
And the following month I've asked Rick Burden of Down Under.
Love
Security.
Controversy, yes.
Yes, and Rick's great. He's he does a lot of, actually I thought you'd find him interesting. He does a lot of case studies where he goes into houses and he doesn't charge people to remove the spirits inside the houses. So I thought you'd find him fascinating. So he's coming on in June, and if Karen gets her book out, we should have her on with Rick as well. So
I could talk about my experiences.
That could be quite an interesting discussion. So because that's one of the areas I'm quite fascinated in, the whole not removing the spirit.
Fantastic, yes.
Just
and I was talking to Rodrigo.
A little darker than others.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was talking to Rodrigo today about the fact that because I'm not very good on the internet, you know, I'm not quite sure how to add callers. So Rodrigo is going to give me some lessons.
Oh, excellent.
So that'll be really good. So we can maybe take some outside calls as well. That's why Rodrigo was coming on and producing for me, so we could have outside calls if we wanted to, because I don't, as you know, I don't normally take outside calls. But I think it would be good, you know, to be able to have some people call in, you know, even if we had a half-hour segment or something like that where people could call in and actually ask questions or share their thoughts on the things we're talking about. So that's something I'm going to be working on, learning how to do that. It's, so there's always something new, isn't there? If I haven't learned something new every day, I think I've missed out. So that's something I'm putting out for in the future, to be able to do that. So all exciting. But fantastic that you've invited some people, Sharon Ann. Thank you. That's awesome.
It's good for me too, for the magazine, because it gives the columnists that little outlet. And I mean, as I said, it's this information, it shouldn't just be, it should be shared and it should be disseminated everywhere if possible. A lot of people prefer to hear things rather than actually sit down and read a book. So it's wonderful to have it in a different medium for once as well.
Yes, that's true. And it's also great to get like-minded people together, because quite often we're very isolated, aren't we?
Well, yes. Karen and I aren't. We live 10 minutes away. Yes, yeah, but I know what you're saying.
Right. It's interesting, Sheila, where I live in Bilberry, I wasn't going to say the suburb. It's been known as the Bible Belt.
It is. Like, we actually had an incident about 5 years ago where somebody cut off a pig's head and threw it in the front of one of the churches.
The new church, and they weren't even spiritual. It wasn't even a spiritual church, but
our Bible Belt of Brisbane.
They were
here.
A tiny bit alternative, but they weren't actually. Mm. Yeah.
And then there's Karen and I in the midst of it, the atheist or agnostic, and the spiritualist. We should go down and do a C5 outside the front of them. That'd get them going. They've got lots of land.
Yes, but thank goodness for Skype these days. Yes. And I have people travel.
Well, as you know, Sharon, I lived up at Springbrook on the mountain until a few weeks ago.
Mm.
Nice.
I still love that place, but it's so difficult to. It's a good 2 hours from where we are, so we have to. Mm. If we come down, we actually have to stay overnight, really.
Mm.
That sound awful. Probably to all the southerners, they probably think 2 hours is nothing, but for Brisbane people, that's a long drive.
All at night,
you know. You know, 2 hours is like traffic going to work for Sydney people, isn't it? Whereas, I think it would kill most of us in Brisbane to stay in traffic that long.
Well, I go and visit my children from Melbourne, and where I'm in Melbourne at the moment, it's about 5 hours drive.
That's a lot. Did you go?
And I've done that, you know, drive up, drop a dog off, have a cup of coffee, and drive back again. Years ago, not recently, but years ago. So I'm a bit of a driver. I spent a long time not being able to drive. So when I actually was allowed to learn to drive again 20 years ago, it was quite an exciting time. To be able to get in the car and just go places. So I really love it. But I know you introduced me to someone at Springbrook that, you know, I thought would be very open to what we do. And you find the walls go up when you start talking about things that are too much different.
Mm. Yes, I was surprised at that as well. But I don't actually think that was... our company, there was a third party involved that kind of soured the deal there, Sheila, so don't take it personally.
Oh, no, absolutely not.
So sometimes people, you also find in communities there are people that are really just out for themselves, and sadly, if in the spiritual communities in particular, we're all expecting everybody to be like we are, which is open, honest, and wanting to be empathic, you know, and help people.
Yeah.
But all you need is one or two narcissists to get into those kind of communities, and they can cause an awful lot of problems. I know I know two people in the last 5 year period that have caused some awful, awful breakups.
And that's us for tonight. Thank you, ladies, Sharon Ann Rowland and Karen Langford. And we've shared on the chat room. So thanks again, ladies, and we'll see you again. And I'll be back again next week.
Thanks, Sheila. Bye.
Bye now. Bye.